Now, moving on with our keynote session of this morning, we're very pleased to welcome back again on this stage Mr. David Sanger. David is still the national security correspondent for the New York Times in Washington. He's going to share his thoughts today on how to avoid cyber conflict among nations. David, please.
Oh, thank you. Well, thank you very much. I can see the hearty few here who have held on to the last day and the last morning. So it's good to see all of you, and thank you very much for having me here. It's particularly kind of you to invite a journalist to come up and talk to you folks when the journalists in the audience, myself included, have had a chance to learn so much from many in industry and in academia here. So let me start this with a story of something that happened not quite 8 years ago. In the first week of January of 2009, President-elect Barack Obama walked across the street from Blair House, the guest house on Pennsylvania Avenue, and went over to the White House for a great American tradition, which is the president-elect's private meeting with the outgoing president of the United States. It's supposed to be a non-political moment, a moment where you talk about the kind of threats that the new president is going to see in the next week or two, and will get intensively involved in almost moments after entering the White House. So Mr. Obama walked in, President Bush was there, and after pleasantries, he said, look, there are two programs that I know you're probably not all that interested in. I heard what you said on the campaign trail, but trust me, you're going to want to keep these programs operating, up and running, when you're sitting behind this desk. One of them was the unmanned aerial vehicle program, UAV program, that we all know as the drone program. That was probably the least covert program in the United States. Every time there was a drone strike, you read about it within hours in the newspapers, saw them on Pakistani TV. At that time, most of the strikes were in Pakistan. Read about them in Long War Journal, Short War Journal, you name the journal, it was there. Then he talked to him about another program called Olympic Games, which was at the time the most covert, or among the most covert programs the United States had going. And that, of course, was the cyber attacks on the Natanz nuclear enrichment plant, which had just begun and gotten going and were underway, but hadn't really achieved the kind of success, and we can debate later how successful they were, that we later came to know when they became public. Now, Olympic Games had a very clear political goal, and we've talked a lot this morning about whether or not the attacks that have happened, we've seen accelerate, were in fact Clausewitzian in nature, which is to say whether they were an extension of politics by other means. The clear intention of Olympic Games was to slow down the Iranian nuclear program, to give time and space for a negotiation with Iran, one that ended up with the nuclear agreement last summer in Vienna, and that also demonstrated to the Iranians, even if the messaging was a little subtle, because as we've discussed this morning, it wasn't immediately clear to them whether or not they were under attack or their centrifuges were just failing, was an effort to make sure that the Iranians knew that one way or another, the United States and its allies would stop Iran from producing a nuclear weapon. Wasn't the only way. We were beginning sanctions. Obama then expanded the sanctions considerably. When you ask American officials today in public what brought the Iranians to the negotiating table, they will say to you, the sanctions did it. Over time, they so crunched the economy that even the hardliners had no choice. If you ask them in private, they will tell you a mix of the sanctions and the sabotage did it. And the sabotage includes Olympic Games. It probably includes, though they don't say it, those assassinations of scientists you heard referred to earlier today, though that was not apparently a US operation. And it included other steps that were taken to squeeze the Iranian regime. Not necessarily to force them into an act of war, quite the opposite. In fact, to force them into a negotiation. Okay, so that's what happened. And then, of course, you know the rest of the story, and I've written some of this in a book that came out 4 years ago this week, actually, called Confront and Conceal. There'll be a documentary out called Zero Days. It'll be in the theaters in the United States in early July that plays out this story at some length, both the technological hunt for Stuxnet and then the journalistic hunt for what, who was behind it and how. I think you'll enjoy. But the core objective here was a highly political one. And President Obama, when he got down into the Situation Room and learned about it and unrolled that, what they called the horse blanket that showed all of the centrifuges and the ways that the cyber attacks would go affect them, had a lot of concerns about whether or not this set of attacks would in fact be used eventually as an excuse by Russia or China or North Korea or Iran or other nations to step out and conduct cyber attacks of their own. Even if they weren't as narrowly targeted, even if they didn't have as clear political objectives, the concern that the president had was that we could be touching off that arms race that John just referred to. So now let's speed forward by 8 or 9 months. It's January 2017, and Donald Trump is walking out of the guest house and across to the White House. Or Hillary Clinton is coming down from her nice house in Northwest. You can, depending on your political orientation and the way you want to think about the next year or two or four or eight of your life, you can imagine either one walking in for that same conversation. It will be a very different conversation if it is Mr. Trump versus Secretary Clinton, but we'll set that aside for another talk on another day. So they're having the same conversation, and maybe the president is updating his successor about some other covert operations. Maybe it includes the publicly announced cyber actions against ISIS. Maybe it has something to do with North Korea or some other adversary. I don't know anything here. I'm just speculating. But my guess is that when they get into that conversation about cyber, if they get that far, it's going to be a very different one than the one 8 years ago. That President Obama is going to be saying, look, at the time that we were doing that, the arms race hadn't really begun. It's in full swing now, and we need some better deterrence. That if we failed at one thing as a government in recent times, I think it's probably been in creating high enough costs for this low level of conflict that we've all been discussing. Now, that low level of conflict is an interesting one, because it raises the question, have we learned anything from the past half century, from the Cold War, from the nuclear age, maybe even from the drone wars, that would help inform for us ways in which we can keep this low level of conflict that's been described here for the past 2.5 days at a truly low level. The challenge is to make sure that what we've seen as an arms race doesn't flame up into a bigger conflict. Now, this is not the first time the United States, the West, other nations, even the Kremlin, have faced this kind of issue. We had it in the 1950s. In 1957, Henry Kissinger published a fascinating book called Nuclear Weapons and Foreign Policy that raised for the first time whether or not it would be possible to conduct limited nuclear war. Because he said mutually assured destruction was crazy, because at the end of it, we got the D, we got destruction. Now, you can say what you want about Mr. Kissinger, who just had his 93rd birthday, and is among America's more controversial figures, about whether or not you think the idea of conducting a limited nuclear war was feasible or even should have been publicly discussed. But in any case, that was the concept he had. And I think one of the interesting questions for us is it possible to have a limited cyber war? In other words, if this did escalate, are there limits on it that could keep it from becoming catastrophic? Now, you've got to come to these analogies with a good deal of humility. When I was a student, I studied under a great professor named Ernest May, who wrote a book about the abuse of analogies in history. It's called Thinking in Time. You can still find it on Amazon. It was published years ago, but it is still one of the best descriptions of how policymakers, decision makers, journalists, particularly journalists, can be led astray by what seems to be an easy analogy to another time. And the nuclear analogies, I want to say right up front, have a lot of flaws. They're vivid. We use them a fair bit, and you'll see them in 0 days. But I think that you'll find that on further reflection, they don't bear a lot of resemblance to the problem that we're facing in cyber. First of all, nuclear began with a huge public event of cataclysmic consequences. President Obama just went out for the first presidential discussion and memorial of this at Hiroshima. So we began with a weapon that got demonstrated to the world. There was no question who owned it. There was no question who used it. And there was no question about its destructive capability. In fact, that capability was so huge that fortunately, so far, no one's ever used one again in anger. And let's hope that that stays the same. But that's quite different than cyber. It's the opposite of cyber. In cyber, the effects are subtle. In cyber, of course, you can dial it up and down. You can make it a small attack or make it a big attack. And as we've seen in the discussion of attribution here over the past 2 days, it's relatively easy, at least for a while, to create doubt about who was the originator of the attack. That last problem, that attribution problem, goes to the core of the deterrence issue. In the nuclear age, you could walk into a big cave in Cheyenne Mountain in Colorado, just had its 50th anniversary, and go look up on the screen, and you could see the missile tracks, and you knew exactly where, or thought you knew exactly where, the missiles were coming from, and you probably knew the names and addresses of the people who were responsible for launching it. And so it was relatively easy to hold another state's territory at risk. In cyber, you don't have any of that. You don't have a mountain you can go into. You don't have a missile track to look at. If you did, it might show up at Mrs. Smith's house two blocks away where the botnet is coming out of her laptop and she doesn't know about it. And it would be a real shame if you then turned around and blew up Mrs. Smith's house. So we have a big deterrence problem. And we have an arms control problem that comes out of that. Because in the days of the Cold War, you could sign a treaty with a few nations that had nuclear weapons, and we started with the Soviet Union. We forget that it was more than 20 years after the Hiroshima and Nagasaki that we got to that. So if you think about that in cyber terms, we're nowhere near that moment. But cyber weapons are so easy to develop, so cheap. Another big difference with nuclear, doesn't require access to a rare source of fuel like uranium or plutonium, that basically anyone can do it. It could be a state, could be a criminal group, could be a hacktivist, could be a teenager. And that's why no one's really discussing treaties in this area. You don't get teenagers to sign treaties. At least in my household, you don't get teenagers to sign treaties. So we have to pretty much dispense with the nuclear analogy, with one significant exception, one concept that I think it's worth playing with, and that goes back to Kissinger. It's his idea that limited nuclear war could stay limited. In cyber, there's good reason to think that could well be the case. It's one of the reasons that the Pentagon turned around a few years ago and turned out a policy. Some of you in the room, I suspect, were involved in this to one degree or another, that basically said the response to a cyber attack may not be a cyber attack, may not be a cyber response. It could be an economic sanction at the one end. It could be a military action, a missile attack. It could even be nuclear. Now, there's a big question of credibility there. Does anybody believe that we would respond to a cyber attack with a military response? But you could imagine that if somebody shut down the entire East Coast of the United States, electric grid, cell phone, whatever, that could, if we understood exactly who it was, lead to a very severe non-cyber response. So the fact that cyber has been blended with all of these other kinds of military actions actually gives you some control on the issues of escalation here. And may mean, and may explain why, we haven't seen that cyber Pearl Harbor that so many politicians love to rail about to grab headlines. Because almost all the cyber activity we have seen, as was demonstrated in this morning's interesting panel discussion, has been below the level that would trigger a much larger response. Now, that's not to say that the responses at the other end have been strong enough to discourage this activity. When I wrote about Olympic Games 4 years ago, and I looked around, I had a hard time finding another example. There were a few, but not many, of cyber being used as a replacement for sabotage or an act of war. Lots of espionage. Tons of espionage, economic, military, whatever. But nothing quite like what Stuxnet did in adjusting industrial control systems and having real-world effects. Since that time, we've had lots. The Ukraine power outage we talked about the other day. That bizarre German steel case. Whatever happened to the Sands Casino. I could go on and on. Some have been successful, some haven't. It's a convincing argument made this morning that Saudi Aramco was not a terribly successful case, and I agree with my friend Jay on that issue. But still, we've seen more attempts. And that's got to be worrisome to whoever comes into the Oval Office next. So if we don't like our nuclear analogies, let's think about some others. We haven't seen broad use of biological weapons, even though those could be in the hands of non-state actors. But they differ from cyber in that you have to be physically present to place a biological weapon, or even a chemical weapon, usually. And you're dependent on lots of other things that can go wrong, even the wind. But it's interesting that that's an example of a weapon we all worried about that so far, fortunately, we have not seen used. Now, drones are a really fascinating element. The other part of that discussion between President-elect Obama and President Bush at that time. There's an oddity about drones, and it's the oddity in the way governments and policymakers think about making use of them versus cyber weapons. Now, if you think about it, in the past decade, armed drones have been aimed at killing people, mostly suspected terrorists. Offensive cyber weapons, in contrast, have been focused on facilities, on equipment that can be repaired, on disrupting networks, so forth. You would think that that would create more of a disincentive to use a drone than to use a cyber weapon. But in fact, it's been the opposite. President Obama, in his first term, authorized 300 drone strikes in Pakistan versus 48 strikes in the entire Bush administration. Sixfold increase. Didn't hear a whole lot about that during his reelection campaign in 2012 because it didn't fit his liberal base's thought about how he was separating himself from President Bush. And it didn't fit the conservative narrative that he was a community organizer unwilling to go use force. So since it didn't fit anybody's narrative, they just didn't discuss it. But those are the numbers. At the same time, there was a great hesitance to use many cyber weapons. Why is that? Well, one reason is that cyber weapons have unpredictable effects, as we've discussed here earlier today. You're not quite sure what that collateral damage is going to be. For the drone strike, you've got some unpredictability as well, but it isn't where the thing's going to strike, it's who happens to wander by at that time, who may get injured or killed. And if you haven't seen Eye in the Sky, the movie that's come out about a drone strike and the debates between Americans and the United States, it's worth seeing just to get at the core of that debate. And many friends of mine who've been involved in those debates tell me it's quite realistic. Put it on your summer movie list. In cyber, there has been such a hesitance that President Obama himself last fall had to get on top of US Cyber Command to convince them to go after ISIS. They had been so focused in his mind on Russia and China, Iran and North Korea, that they weren't putting their effort into what was the most immediate threat to the United States. That's pretty interesting. That the president himself had to step in to go convince the command that was created and promoting cyber to go use their own weaponry. Worth thinking about again. Now, there's a thought as well about deterrence, about the reasons that we might not want to go use these weapons. In the drone arena, we came to believe over time that the image of the United States was being so soiled by the use of drones that we might be creating more terrorists with each strike than we were actually killing. And if over time there's a similar stigma that goes on about offensive cyber, depending on how it's used, you could imagine that also being a limit on how quickly and how often cyber is employed. But again, that requires pretty good attribution. Now, I'm running out of time here, so let me just conclude with this thought. Cyber is an area where the government's own secrecy about the program is getting in the way of the deterrent effect. Now, you would expect to hear a journalist argue against government secrecy, because I spend most hours of most days trying to pry out an understanding of what's going on, and not just in the cyber arena, from a government that doesn't want to talk about it. And that's true whether Democrats are in office, Republicans are in office, or Martians are in office. Once in office, they will be secretive. But in the cyber arena, we've imposed more secrecy because we didn't have an original event like Hiroshima or Nagasaki that made it obvious that we had the weapon and we had the capability. And so the administration has spent the past 8 years trying to figure out how to go talk about this whole thing. They've never acknowledged Olympic Games and Stuxnet, even though there have been multiple books and so many articles written about them, many by people in this room. You could imagine another scenario in which talking about Stuxnet, why it was used, what they thought they were accomplishing, what they could accomplish in the future, would be a very big part of the deterrence. Will they be able to say everything? No. But in the nuclear age, we kept everything about the weapon themselves secret. How you build them, where you put them, who's authorized to go use them. And yet we had a roiling debate in the United States about how we wanted to use the weapon. And it ended up in a completely different place than it started off. Douglas MacArthur wanted to use nuclear weapons against the North Koreans and the Chinese. We had some crazy generals during the Cuban Missile Crisis who suggested that we use the moment to end it all with the Soviet Union. Yeah, we might lose 70 million Americans, but at least the Cold War would be over. We ended up deciding, no, we would only use these weapons as a matter of national survival. Now, that's not, in my view, where the cyber weapons debate is going to end up, because the effects are not usually as great. But we've never even had the debate publicly about how we want to go use these weapons, and I suspect that's overdue. So I'm sure, I hope I have time for one or two questions, and I thank you very much, and thank you for having me here today. It's been great being here in Tallinn for your sessions.
Are there any questions from the floor? Oh, this gentleman here.
Hi, David. Thanks for that. That was fantastic. Jay Healy from Columbia University. We have seen, I mean, it has been a change that in 2016 that we've got U.S. officials talking about cyber attacks, living up to it and say, yes, this was us that was hitting Islamic State. So one, walk us through the dynamics of why they decided to step out from behind the veil of attribution and come out and talk about it. And how do you think that dynamic, now that a nation state has come out and said, yes, this is us doing this stuff, how does that change how other nations might in the future of cyber conflict?
It's a great question, Jay, and I've been asking it of a lot of people. So the first answer I've gotten is a bureaucratic one, that the action against ISIS is a military action, what we call in the United States a Title 10 action. So it's under the military authorities of the president. You can talk about those and you can do this. Whereas Stuxnet, Olympic Games, and other cyber actions have frequently been under what's called Title 50, which is the intelligence guides intelligence operations and are required by law to be kept secret and deniable. So the fact that they've kept this in the military channel has enabled them to talk about it. But I hope that there's something bigger and different going on here. That in fact, by talking about it, they're trying to mix it with the psychological warfare and the information warfare that we were discussing earlier, and that they wanted ISIS to wonder, when they got that message showing up in their email that says, meet at the third tree by the oil refinery for our 11 a.m. staff meeting, whether or not that was a genuine message or a message sent by somebody who was a drone operator for a friend. And so under those circumstances, discussing the fact that they're in manipulating data, I think they thought worked to their advantage.
Maybe one last question from the floor. One quick question to you, David, if I may. One of my colleagues coined the term mutual assured doubt for the context we're living in. What do you think, do you think this would qualify the context we're living in now?
Well, mutually assured doubt certainly fits a cyber strategy in which manipulation of data is a key element. So let's guess for a moment, let's speculate for a moment that what Symantec and others have said is true, and that it's the North Koreans who are behind some of these attacks that have run through the SWIFT system. We don't have any firm evidence of that yet. We know what the reports are that we've read, but there are some reasons to question it. Perhaps this is just theft of money. But if it had a bigger purpose, it would be to convince, or to sow doubt, I guess, in the minds of anybody who's engaged in an international financial transaction, from which the North Koreans are largely excluded, that transaction they're seeing is real. That it actually is a transfer that they can rely on, that the message can be authenticated. And if that's the case, it could well point to what the future of cyber operations are all about, which is to make you distrustful of your own system.
Thank you very much, David.
Thank you.
Here, a small
Thank
token.
Thank you very much.